Listen, like, I really just want people to understand me and Preem, man. Because people don't understand me and Preem.
They want to.
Preem, that's family. It's my brother. I told Preem, you ain't got to sell no drugs. You ain't got to do anything illegal, and let's just have fun.
Right.
You could be vice president of Murder, Inc. Anybody that's in the streets, the offer that I gave Preem is taking the offer. They getting a six-figure check. They running around with Murder, Inc. with the artist. They ain't got to worry about going to jail. Niggas killing them. They taking it. And Preem came back to me like 2 days. The first thing he said was how much he loved me. He's like, God, ain't no one cared for me like this. You know what I'm saying? He said, I want you to know I love you, nigga. Like, you my man, you my brother. We together till the fucking casket drops. And after he said all of that good shit, but I can't accept the offer. I said, what you talking about? Why? He said, yo, I won't be praying. If I'm the vice president of Murder, Inc., I can't be praying. I said, yo, what if you go to jail? And the nigga said, nigga, if I go to jail, I'm Preem in jail. Yo, what if you get killed? My tombstone will read Kenneth Supreme Grip. He's the only way I ain't gonna be Preem is if I take a job under my man. That level of commitment to who he is, niggas don't have that.
Prosecution to let him plead to a 12-year plea, but we got credit for all the time he had served on the state case, so he only wound up serving 4 years. They were crazed. The agents went nuts over the fact that he got out so quickly, and they saw him on the street. What's he doing on the street?
I was in transition to complete legitimacy, but the streets changed when I got home. A lot of the leadership was not present that was present in the 80s.
Preem was so highly regarded. I don't know if you know, but when you wanted to tell the truth and I was talking to somebody, we would say, word to Preem. Like, he was like this god. And so now, when you get to see him, it's like, yo, that's Preem right there. And everybody's like, where? It's like, oh, yo, that's really him.
This is a man who's a notorious boss. So how do you handle coming home? There might be beefs. People don't trust you. People scared of you. They might not want to talk business with you. At the 90s, you know, everybody started to, you know, look at rap like there's a whole new wave of young rappers coming up. When you saw the Ja Rules and the Lost Boys and Onyx, so many that just came out in the 90s alone. I think it was so new. It was just bigger than anything anybody thought about. And Irv was a perfect person to try to help Preem change his life.
Turn this up, baby. Let him feel it out here.
I am Irv Gotti, and I do everything from the rooter to the tutor. I go in the studio, I make the record, I work with the artists, I direct the video. When I drop I'm Real or Always On Time or Foolish or Ain't It Funny or all of these number one records that I've had, they're undeniable hits.
funny thing is, Irv wasn't from Southside. Irv was from Hollis. Before the music, he used to come on this side. He used to be with Prem and everything. He started out doing little things for Russell. He's got in his mind this is how music is supposed to be set up, and he did it.
Clay's relationship with Irv was more like that of a big brother. In fact, he told me that he liked Irv because he liked how he treated his moms and his siblings and stuff like that.
I don't think McGriff had a lot of money. And he saw the entertainment business as his pathway to not only wealth, but position.
He'd have been at least one, maybe two steps away from it.
They don't understand like how a gangster like Prem could be honestly just a really good, great dude. They only see the gangster side. They only see the bad.
When did you meet
him? I met Supreme, and me and Prem became me and Prem on the set of the Cash Money Click video, which was like 94.
Y'all were hanging every day?
Every day. He was at a halfway house at MDC.
He just came home.
So we would pick him up from Brooklyn, and we would go back to the block, be on in Godwood, just laughing, joking, in Baisley, 40, wherever we was at, go get something to eat, and just having a good time. You gotta understand, Prem was with me before Murder, Inc.
This is Cash Money Click.
Right, I'm not getting no money. So Prem watched the growth of his man. So when I got to the level I'm making $20 million a year, I love Prem. He watched everything go. I was DJ Irv and producing and making records. I got a label deal. I had the label deal, I didn't have a name. So I'm sitting watching Arts and Entertainment, A&E, Gangsta Week. Lucky Luciano, John Gotti, Benny Siegel, Al Capone. And sure enough, on today's episode, we focus on Albert Anastasia and the notorious Murder, Incorporated. And Murder, Inc. came across the TV, and then they got riddled with bullets. And then they was like, they was the notorious contract hitmen. I'm like, literally, I'm in my fucking little two-bedroom bullshit apartment screaming. I'm a hitman. I want to make contract hits. This is Murder, Inc. My artists will be called murderers. First person I call, Rule.
Yo, Murder, Inc. He's like, oh, that's hot.
Second person, Hov.
Nigga, Murder, Inc. What do you think he's like, nigga, that's hot?
Once I heard it from Rule and Hov, no one is going to talk me off this ledge now. I didn't know years later I'd be in court explaining this.
Murder, Inc. was a loose confederation of Jewish and Italian gangsters from Brownsville in East New York who, as you might suspect from their name, killed a lot of people. It was hitmen for hire, essentially. If you look at labels like Murder, Inc., you realize how potent the gangster myth remained. Organized crime in New York is always about ethnic succession. So, you know, the Irish had their day, the Jews had their day, the Italians. Now it was time for another kind of gangster.
I thought I was invincible. We getting money, we got the biggest hit, number one record.
First of all, I want to thank God. I want to thank my dog, Irv Gotti.
We with J-Lo. Then we get, I'm making like 20, 25 million a year.
Ashanti!
You know, being a new artist, first album, and, you know, garnering that much success and love and having your crew, you know, it was an amazing, amazing experience.
I gotta thank the radio stations for giving us all the play. Definitely my family.
The chemistry, just being with the Long Island Queens thing was just a thing. It was kind of just like an organic energy that happened. I just felt. I was like the girl from Long Island amongst all the wolves. You know what I mean? He was built up to be this big bad, you know, Supreme. You know, like the perception was like the big bad wolf, you know? And then when you meet him, he said, oh, hey, Supreme. You know, you got the light eyes and the waves. You know, and I'm like, why is everybody scared of him? Like, you know what I mean? And I just remember
remember him being super supportive, super funny, you know. He definitely always made me feel like I was safe, you know, like little sis, you know what I mean? So it was weird because I knew a lot of people feared him. I knew what the perception was. But around me, he was just Preem, you know what I mean? And I guess that was like the yin and the yang, like the balance.
When I was with McGriff, we had a very good relationship, and I would call him out on his foibles, but I think to the public, and even to the people who were up in Murder, Inc.'s offices, who looked at Kenny walk through as though he were a god.
He was still around when a lot of kings were buried in the penitentiary or the ground. He's the last of those guys. It felt like he was really trying to be humble about it and just really learn this new industry. That's how it seemed to me. He seemed genuine.
Kenny sponsored and protected so many people in the rap business, from Jay in his early days and others along the way, Ja Rule, Ligottis. Kenny would ride on buses with some of them when they would go from location to location and perform, to let everybody know he was there to protect them. And they then incorporated him and the Supreme Team into their lyrics.
Yo, when you didn't talk for the South Side, you get down iller. Supreme was the businessman and Prince was the killer. Remember?
This is around 99, 2000. I took interest in the case and started to look at the lyrics 50 Cent wrote. And the first interesting thing he wrote was that Supreme was the businessman and Prince was the killer. Apparently that was a no-no in the community. Exposing bad guys in your song without, you know, them getting some kind of benefit from it was not the right thing to do.
I want to take hip-hop to being like back. Like back to when we were a little more competitive. Now it's to the point where the artist is even scared to say your name. Like,
you know, with 50, the Ghetto Quran, it's like, oh wow, he's from out there. So, you know, he can really get more in depth with the story.
You know, people look at it and go, well, he wasn't supposed to say that about me. Like, you know what I mean? Like,
and I was like, damn, you know, you got to leave some out for speculation. You can't. And he tried to, but, you know, he gave it up. And that's why it's called Ghetto Quran. But, you know, of course, some things started. You know what I'm saying? Because a lot is being said in these records.
There came a point in time where McGriff decided that 50 Cent had to go. And so he drove around looking for 50 in various places. Another Supreme Team associate had found out that 50 Cent was going to be at his grandmother's house. So Kenneth McGriff and Rob Lyons went over.
May 24th, the car pulled up. The guy got out the passenger seat of that car, came around behind it, and shot through the actual car.
And Rob apparently was the shooter in this incident, shot 50 Cent 9 times.
Did you ever find out who did it?
Yeah, I knew who did it shortly after.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And they are now where?
Oh, the guy who actually shot me is dead. And the guy who paid him got life in jail.
Got life in jail.
Yeah.
Even he couldn't really truthfully say I'm a bad dude. Even the difference that we had or whatever situation we had, he knows why that happened and where it's at. He knows that I'm a straight shooter. You know what I'm saying? I'm fair. And we had many discussions before that incident took place. So he knows where I'm at.
Yeah, I love Fifth, man. He plays this thing all the way up, man. 50's a hustler. He definitely was in the street selling drugs, carrying guns, sticking the people up. And then he caught this thing where he could say, look, F the Supreme Team, and it worked for him. And he won't let it go. But it's part of his niche now. He can't even think about letting it go. He's made so much money talking about it. Preem gotta disrespect this gangster. He's just doing it in a rap way. If they was in a room together, I don't think they'd have a fight. Preem would probably be like, yo, man, what are you doing? And he'd be like, yo, I'm making money. I truly believe that.
I don't even know what feeling my uncle actually had about it. I know that what he tried to do, I said, man, I don't even want to see people beefing. I don't want to see that type of shit. They getting money, they getting paid. You know what I'm saying?
gotta do, and if they bring in South Jamaica, attention.
So when McGriff became friendly with Irv Gotti, I think Irv really was enamored with the legend of Supreme. It was one of the first times I ever saw a record producer with the bad guys as opposed to the artist himself. Irv Gotti thought he was, maybe his association with Supreme made him a bigger, tougher guy than he was.
It was this one detective named William Court. This guy was like a groupie, man. He likes big names, but I know that he was fixated on trying to put Supreme away. While I was doing my first federal bid, I decided when I went home, I would bring to fruition my vision of turning Donald Goins novels into films.
Nobody kills cops in this town and gets away with it.
This is on and popping tonight.
Yeah.
You see, if niggas playing like this more often, we all be in better shape.
Guys like McGriff and a lot of guys in prison, they read just a few books. They all read Sun Tzu. They all read Machiavelli. And they all read Donald Goins. And so it was McGriff's dream while he sat in prison was to turn that book, Crime Partners, into a film. And that was his agenda.
I see you got big plans, Kenyatta.
But my biggest plan of all is death to white racist cops.
Well, what was interesting about the movie, it's one, it's I think 3 out of 10 on Rotten Tomatoes. But one thing of interest is it was largely financed by credit card fraud, drug trafficking, loans.
Right. Yo, count this from.
For clarity, what's Crime Partners?
Crime Partners is the movie that Preem made, that he funded himself. And it wasn't just me that gave him money. Darren from Rough Riders gave him money, and Hove gave him money. All legitimate, real shit.
He got into the making of Crime Partners, doing legitimate stuff. Man, I was just excited about it. It didn't surprise me because he always had an entrepreneurial spirit, right? It didn't surprise me that he would try to make a turn.
It seems that every guy in the narcotics business, when they get out, if their organization is strong enough, they step right back into it. Nathan May, Baby Wise, these were all guys that, you know, that kind of believed in Supreme. And he was still their charismatic leader. Supreme was certainly a multi-kilo dealer. I think a large portion of that money went to finance this film, which was his dream.
Well, Supreme is involved in it, it has to be drugs. It had nothing to do with drugs. It had nothing to do with money laundering. It had to do with pure business.
He wanted to be a director. And one time we were at a mall and they had a director's chair. And he went and sat in that chair. And you could see it in his eyes, had his passion, because that was something that he always wanted to do. Crime Partners made $4 million. I had him $1 million soundtrack deal. That's $5 million he makes up. He does it all. He's off and running.
The black man's gonna have his day yet.
Especially with you letting them dog.
That's right.
And Preem, he did a great job with preparing that. He had Snoop Dogg in there, Ice-T, he had them all.
Preem had a plan.
You know, so he had a plan, you know? He had a plan.
Preem had a plan and he was working on his plan.
Yeah, he was working on his plan.
He was working on his changes, he was working yes. on, he was in transition stages to whatever they, you know, perceived him as out here. He
Listen.
Was changing whatever reputation these people gave him. And he was doing it greatly and they didn't allow him to do that.
There came a point where we knew that that McGriff had some type of involvement in a double homicide in Baltimore, Maryland. Some guys he'd been working with had a beef over some drugs. So Baltimore County Police found out that the victim was living in this apartment in the complex where it happened, and they did a search warrant. They found some effects belonging to a guy named Lee Toon. There was also a pistol training course completion certificate under the name Lee Toon, and there was also a videotape. So as I was viewing this tape, I realized that the tape contained a scene of a woman filming a car that's idling in the Queens section of New York, and she's on the phone giving directions to a hit team. just moments before the hit team sets up, the videotape ends. So my partner Tony Castiglia was able to piece together some background noise, which was a TV show, and establish the exact time that the video was made. And that was the exact time that E Moneybags was killed.
Now, E Moneybags was a Brooklyn, Queens guy, a no-nonsense guy, cool guy, fun guy. He was doing his thing, I was doing my music thing. And we was hanging out like almost every day.
He became involved in some kind of car deal with McGriff and a guy from New Jersey. And somewhere along the line, he lost a decent amount of cash. And he came to McGriff and he wanted him to make things right. McGriff refused to do so. They end up getting in a shootout with each other, and McGriff's right-hand man, Black Just, gets shot. And en route to the hospital, he bleeds out and dies. At that point, Supreme knows this is going to be an ongoing problem, and these guys got to go.
E Moneybags killed Black Just. You're not killing someone as close as Black Just, Supreme, and think you're going to be good. No.
So they were foolish enough to leave this memorialized tape behind the scene. And we got a real break on the case when a detective from Manhattan North Narcotics arrested McGriff buying some marijuana.
So he riding around with Benz, he got pulled over. He had like 25,000 cash, right? And a gun. So the police go, yo, you know, you got 25,000? He said, yeah, you catching me on a light day, nigga. I'm like, what are you doing? And then I gave him a card, like vice president, murder ring. He gave him a card.
And he had the alias Lee Tootin in his possession, which we matched to the gun certificate and other effects that were in the house. So, you know, that kind of put a lot of things together for us, and it was very helpful in the investigation.
BJ was like, nigga, why'd you fucking tell him that? Like, yes, there was a lot of things in hindsight that they were like, yo, you shouldn't have done that. You put the energy on Murder Ring. You wasn't moving like a record exec. You was moving like a drug dealer.
Federal investigators in the New York City Police Department raided the Manhattan offices of Murder, Inc., which is in the same building as Def Jam Records and his parent Universal Music. So what's it all about? Well, according to a story in the LA Times, the FBI is looking into an alleged connection between Irv and a convicted Queens drug lord named Kenneth McGriff, a.k.a. Supreme.
Today's indictment does indeed tell a simple story of a crime partnership that dealt in three commodities: drugs, murder, and money laundering.
Investigators say the laundered money financed a direct-to-video movie called Crime Partners. McGriff was listed as executive producer, and the opening paid homage to an associate whose murder McGriff allegedly avenged by the killing of aspiring rapper E Moneybags. The Gotti brothers were released on $1 million bond each.
I am no way in shape, in any way, shape, or form, and that's all that I'm guilty of.
When that happened, it's a scary feeling, and there were so many rumors and so many stories, and it was tough.
Lawyers expect this trial to last about a month, and if they're convicted, the Lorenzo brothers each face up to 20 years in prison and the forfeiture of millions of dollars.
But Irv didn't give a fuck, because his expression was through music and entertainment. You know what I'm saying? Nothing illegal.
They knew their case for me was bullshit. The government offered me a sweet deal. I was facing 20 years. They offered me 6 months. I said, explain money laundering. They said, well, money laundering is Supreme giving you a bag of drug dealing money and you write a check. So me giving him $50,000 for Crime Partners was the whole they thought he gave me. I said, well, Supreme never gave me no money. They said, well, that's not money laundering. I said, so I could give him money and I'm not doing nothing unlawful. They said, no. They said, he would have to have given you money for you for that check. I said, well, that didn't happen. My lawyer was like, think about this. It's 20 years you're facing. This is giving you 6 months. I said right there, that mean I thought about it for like a minute. I said, I ain't fucking my man over. Fuck them niggas. And I faced the 20 years.
What was the verdict and how did you feel when it was announced?
I don't wish that on nobody. It is the most nerve-wracking thing, and you know the balance of shit come back and say guilty, you doing 20. The jury has reached the verdict. I'm like, oh, shit. And I'm just sitting there looking at the jury like, what did y'all do? Not guilty. It was like a movie, the courtroom erupted, the order, order, all that shit. Me and my brother hugged, and it was just an ill feeling. You know, they got Preem on 2 homicides, but they didn't get him on no drug dealing. They didn't even mention that. So in a way that like it helped them by me doing what I did and beating them, it helped them. But I couldn't help them with the homicides.
Yeah, I was paying attention to all that Murder, Inc. stuff, and I was rooting for them. I thought that if they went to trial together, that they would all win because he could have wrote their coattails. But being the man he is, he didn't want no spillover effect from the street life. Irv and them lawyers actually moved for the separate trial, and they got it. But he made that suggestion to Irv and Chris. Man, let's separate these trials, man, because I don't want to get the spillover effect from my past life into your present life.
So we had been monitoring McGriff's two-way pager, and we saw Gerald Prince Miller. So a crew of us from the U.S. Marshals Service jumped on a plane, and we head down to Houston.
Well, when he first came to see me, he came to see me in the limousine, and he let me know that, hey, man, damn, this might be my last time seeing you. You know what I'm saying? I said, why? He said, man, I'm hearing that they might be trying to come get me or something. I was devastated when I found that out.
As we got to Houston, we found out that McGriff just took off and headed over to Miami and had checked into the Lowe's Hotel in Miami Beach. We jumped on a plane. About 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, we knocked on the door, put the pass key in, and found McGriff in bed with a woman, young woman. He surrendered, you know, peacefully. She was kind of raising hell, screaming and yelling, and he told her to calm down. They're just doing their jobs. You know, I was shocked at how calm he was. He didn't, you know, he didn't get angry. He didn't get raised up. When we dropped him off at the correctional facility, he just smiled and said goodbye. He knew something was coming. He knew the case was coming. But, yeah, I mean, he was a gentleman gangster to us.
So the last time that I saw Preem was at the Mesmerize video. Me and Jai were shooting Mesmerize in L.A., and it was at a real carnival. Like, it was a real fair. So it was like Ferris wheels and bumper cars and, you know, stuffed animals where you throw the ball and all that stuff. So it was like such a dope day. So many people came out, super positive energy. And then everything kind of shifted because this was like the last time that we were going to see Preem before, you know, the trial started and everything. So it's just crazy how life can change in an instant, you know, and that's a fact.
So there was this huge writer for the LA Times. The writer calls me, gets my number, says, yo, I want to tell you what this is all about. This is all about Edward Byrne.
As far as Ed Burns, I would never condone such a detrimental act.
I said, what? I ain't got nothing to do with Edward Byrne. And I said, Preem ain't have nothing to do with Edward Byrne. He said, correct. But Preem was a part of the fucking drug dealer crew. Corley, Fat Cat, Tommy. Everybody who was around or associated with that killing of Edward Byrne, he says, the government is not going to let them walk away. And he says, you, because you're saying and screaming this is your man and you love him, you're catching the hell. So when you look at the case, they bled me, they froze my accounts, and they bled all of the money. I was penniless. I was actually $2 million in the hole. So even now, so now Preem has to face a double homicide with a fucking legal aid.
If you get assigned a public defender, you might as well just kill yourself. My lawyer's been practicing law for over 40 years and has never won a federal trial. Not even a hung jury. So why am I to think that I even stand a chance with this guy?
A drug lord with ties to hip-hop and Hollywood was spared the death penalty today by a Brooklyn jury. 46-year-old Kenneth Supreme McGriff was instead sentenced to life in prison without parole for orchestrating the 2001 murders of Eric E. Moneybag Smith and Troy Singleton.
Oh, man, it hurted me when he got life, when he came back to prison, you know what I'm saying? Because I just didn't want that for him, you know what I'm saying? And I know when I get out, I ain't coming back, you know what I'm saying? I ain't even gonna jaywalk.
I was so sick. I was so heartbroken, bro.
How you finally got in with the murder ink and all that? And then they with the Irv and all them. We legit now getting to the bread. I'm like, oh, we rich. We made it. We good. I'm about to come home in a couple more, a few more years or whatever. Like that. I'm thinking, I come home good. We live. I'm talking to them on the phone. Irv talking to DB, talking to whoever on the phone. I'm like, oh, we good. We in there. I ain't got nothing to work. We good.
It almost was there. Although I was with Irv, I was always a guy that did my own thing. So I have my own project. I have my own soundtrack, my own music. I mean, like, I have my own film company and my own music company. So they would have been, everybody would have been straight. But the feds saw otherwise.
All of a sudden, out of nowhere, bam. What the fuck happened? What? No.
Hey, rock me right there. I'm like, oh my God, we back to square one.
What I learned later on was you can't plan to leave the game. You just got to leave. You just got to get out. You got to say, you know what? I don't care if I don't have nothing. I don't care if I got to start over again. I don't care if I have to grind from the bottom up. Wherever you're at in life, you just got to get out. Because if you try to take steps or you try to plan, something's always going to drag you back in.
I never understood, as much as I thought I did, what it means for someone to go to prison for a day, but I do. And you cannot explain it to people. You cannot explain watching people in a visiting room trying to hold a hand of their loved one and not being able to hold their five-year-old son on their lap. You can't, until you see the kids crying when they have to leave, appreciate what that means.
Jail is tough, individual. I mean,
the laws that you take from the things that you do, you don't think about it when you're doing it. But when you're in here, it bothers you.
I think that any sentence above 10 years, accepting the most extraordinary of circumstances, is too much. And 10 years may be too much. It doesn't take long for people who are in prison to appreciate what they are there for and what they've done to their family and themselves. I mean, how much time is too much time?
When you talk about regrets, I think if you don't have regrets, then that means you'll make the same mistake that you did once before and you'll do it again.
At one point, and this is the truth, I didn't like myself back then, you know, because I know what I did to the community, you know. We definitely tore the community down, you know, and we influenced the younger generation that it was all right what we was doing. You know, to this day, you know, I would say Baisley is still messed up because of us.
We just knew we were hustling, but we figured in some cases people would get high, you know, they're going to get it from somebody. That was somewhat of our mentality. I'm not saying, again, I'm not defending it, but in a lot of cases, we had no idea of knowing how, you know, the far-ranging implications and what they would do, you know, to the community.
Did it impact my life? For that moment, it was like a rush. It was like a person who was consuming drugs and feeling high and heavy and mighty. But that was short term.
In the long run, the end results is not good. Because no one wants to be in jail, losing family members. You can't go to funerals, waste, can't do none of that. So you miss out on your children's life, mad, a lot of years in life that they go without you. But when you choose a certain life, all that comes with it. It is what it is. And you gotta accept it.
Gift, man, you can't squander it. You can't wait till you get older and then look back in time and say, I should have did something else. You better start doing something else now. It's too late to look back and say, damn, I wish this or I wish that. You have to look forward now, and you have to expand your mind, and you have to change the reality of it.
I was sentenced to 3 life sentences without the possibility of parole. I did approximately 25 years of time without counting any good time or anything. And I was 848B. I felt obligated to help other people while I was incarcerated, I learned that you have a high percentage of people in there that can't read or write, and that this really doesn't understand procedures or following rules and stuff like that. And what I did was I looked at some of these people as being my brothers, my sons, and even me being in that position. And it just made me feel like I was obligated to assist people. I work as a paralegal now. I own my own company that started out with a paralegal service. We do research for individuals, help them find their transcripts, help them get their transcripts, help them find topics and subjects and be aware of new laws that's coming out that might help them or benefit them in their case. Gerald Miller, he contacted me. He heard about some of the success that we was having on some of the high profile cases and stuff. And he asked if we could help him out.
Hello?
Hi, this is Counselor Bastian from USP Alamut. How are you today?
Good, how are you?
Good. Did you have a call with one of our inmates?
I did, Mr. Miller.
Okay.
I introduced Gerald Miller to Aaron Goldsmith. He's a person with an ear. A lot of attorneys don't like to listen to guys like me. I'll give you an example. I had about 5 attorneys telling me I was wasting my time. I was taking too long and I shouldn't do it. And, well, you know what I can say to those attorneys now? Look where I'm at now.
Good, Gerald. How are you?
I'm good. I'm fine, man.
All right, just to let you know, Tommy's here with me. For me as the attorney to have someone like Tommy, he's much more of an understanding of, like, this is what the guy's mentality is and marrying that to this is what the rules are.
Truth be told, you've been out there begging people like Mr. Walker, like Tommy. He's been out there, and then you got other people, and they're still out successfully with their families in the community doing good, and they all had life without parole. So it makes me, people like me, feel proud that they're doing it. They're doing it the right way. Don't see them coming back. You see them recommitting. So it shows that we can come out and live a decent, law-abiding way of life. So I'm just happy about it. I'm actually ecstatic that I got you and Tommy on the case. So, man, I really appreciate that.
Powder cocaine, a drug of choice among mostly middle and upper-class abusers. Crack cocaine, a potent crystal derivative of powder, a cheaper, faster high for its mostly poor users. Chemically, the drugs are virtually identical, but not in federal court. An arrest for 5 grams of crack brings a mandatory 5 years in federal prison, but you get just the same 5-year sentence for 500 grams of powder cocaine.
In America, the people have rights. The people, we pride ourselves on freedom of speech. We pride ourselves on interaction. We pride ourselves. There's a generation of people who got swallowed up, who went in as kids and got sentenced to a life in jail. And I'm not saying that some of those people are bad and don't deserve to stay in jail their whole life. There are some that do. But to take that on with a wide, you know, with a wide brush instead of being specific is just not fair.
I was in the House of Representatives when the war on drug measure was passed 30 years ago or so. It was at the advent of crack cocaine. It scared the hell out of us. The notion of a cheap narcotic, highly addictive, destructive to mothers and their fetus, led us to impose a sentencing disparity between crack and powder cocaine that was unprecedented. Our notion was to come down hard, make it clear that it was a federal standard, impose that standard, and stop the advance of crack cocaine. We failed from the outset.
The major foundational shifts that happened was the Supreme Court decided the judge who's most familiar with the case should have the discretion to say, to, you know, give a sentence that's higher or lower. It gives us a lot more opportunity as defense attorneys to argue factors about who they are as a person. So that helps a lot. And then the First Step Act is something that happened shortly after.
One of the biggest reforms in decades has just passed the Senate.
In my opinion, too, it's called the First Step Act. It's a sweeping bipartisan bill that overhauls parts of the federal criminal justice system.
Although Prince was sentenced to multiple life sentences, he was never convicted of a violent crime, which makes him eligible for early release under the First Step Act.
The number one criteria to look at is whether or not you're a threat to society. With the older guys, what we try to do in the motion is we use the BOP-owned data and statistics to that, for example, a person over 50 years old, the chances to commit a crime drop down to 10%. And so we might say, for example, Mr. Miller's 50 years old now. According to your own statistics, that you're saying that he has a 10% of chance of coming back to jail, so clearly he's not a threat to society.
Under Section 404 of the First Step Act, I'm requesting immediate release. If the judge, God willing, grants my motion, I'll be able to come home, and it may be automatic right away. So, waiting on a Supreme Court case, and once that comes out, we're filing.
I think Gerald Miller stands a very excellent chance of being successful. When you look at his story as a whole, he's the nephew of Supreme, and he's carrying a lot of Supreme weight on his shoulders from Supreme, and show that he's entitled or he should get a second chance, that he made some of the mistakes that Supreme made and that he's looking to move on with his life. Fat Cat was just granted parole out of New York State. That's something that he probably could use to show or to compare to say, here's an individual that similar situated. Clearly, if he's not a danger or he's not a threat to society, how could I possibly be a threat to society?
All right, take care, Mr. Goldsmith. Tommy, take care, man. I'll be in touch, y'all.
You too, Jerry, brother.
I'll talk to you
all
soon.
Right, then. Talk to you.
Okay, bye-bye.
All right.
Join you here tonight on this auspicious occasion. Tonight, we will swear in the 110th mayor of our great city.
There's a subtext to my journey.
I was arrested in South Jamaica, Queens, when I was coming from school. I was charged with criminal trespassing after going into an apartment of a go-go dancer who owed us money. My little small crew I used to hang out with.
A man whose dedication and vision for this city is steadfast and unwavering.
It says to a person that's sitting in Rikers right now that believe this is the end of the road. No, wait a minute, Eric was arrested. Now every street hustler knows that you don't have to stay where you are. Where you are is not who you are.
Mr. Mayor, would you please raise your right hand and repeat after me?
You can go in the system and use those same abilities that you made to be a street corner CEO, to be a CEO in any way you are. I'm the mayor of the most important city in the most important country on the globe.
Of the office
of the mayor of the city of New York.
Of the mayor of the city of New York.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Every street hustler alive should see the possibilities right now.
There were two ways of looking at things that Martin Luther King had and Malcolm had. Martin looked at it as the American dream, the possibilities of what America can be. And Malcolm that it is the American nightmare, the tragedy of being black in America. All of this, hip-hop, Supreme Team, is the American story. Whether it's the dream of creating a dynasty, whether it's the dream of creating the American nightmare and the American dream at the same time.
Me being able to look back on my life and to think about what changed my views of life allowed me to find my own redemption to change it. I got lost in selling drugs and committing crimes, and I had to come to prison to be awakened to ask myself, damn, what happened?
I believe that everything that people from those communities witnessed over their lives impacted the way they approached life. And if Gerald was impacted by what he saw as a young person, I have no reason to doubt it.
I'm telling you, a person does not want to walk a mile in my shoes, and they definitely don't want to walk 2 years in my shoes. People talk about that life and they rap about it, but this side of it, it ain't as glamorous as people make it out to be.
My life story is about struggle, suffering, resilience, and perseverance. What people should take from it is the shortcut is really the long way and the wrong way. I think people should take the long way anyway. It's more to see.
think about Prem and everything that happened, like, Prem is a really smart guy. And he always struck me as a sincere guy. I'm not saying that, you know, he wasn't on a different side of the line or any of that. But one thing I can say about that guy, he always looked at me in my eyes and I always felt a sense of realness from him and truth from him. All I can tell you is that those days were very inspiring. It showed me a lot of what I wanted to be. It didn't show me everything. You know, I understand John D. Rockefeller and I understand Andrew Carnegie, but there's a place for all of that, right? There's a place for Bill Gates, there's a place for Warren Buffett, and there's a place for these guys. Because they brought something to the table too.
When you talk about the Prem team, man, you're talking about some real motherfuckers, man.
Guys like Prem made it like, yo, that's the Queens cats right there. They in the building.
I know why I'm here. I know how I got here. I know what caused me to think the way that I did. And I no longer think with a criminal-minded, quiet character anymore. If I am given a chance to go home, I will not be the person who blows that opportunity to be a productive individual, man. They'll see me in a different light because they'll see the things I would be doing to help my community, to help my society, to help my family, and they'll all be legitimate. What would they say then? Oh, he's still a member of the Supreme Team? I know my freedom from incarceration is not guaranteed, right? But nonetheless, one day I hope that I'll be able to show the community. But then God willing, give me the opportunity to get a second chance at life. I'm not going to put my head in the sand. I'm not fearful of anything. The community wants me back. I'm definitely coming back to Queens.
Your phone's about to cut off, man.
Yo, you believe when they say we ain't shit, we can't grow. All we are is dope killers and gangsters. And you believe when they be telling you lies. All on the media, they make the world look crazy to keep you inside. Why you listen when the teachers at school know you a young single parent out struggling? They think you a fool. Give your kids bad grades and put them in dumber classes. Kill us for the future. I wonder how do we last it. Underground in their casket, ancestors turning. I'm learning something every day. There is no Lazarus. Words like God is Greek or Latin. So if you study Egypt, you see the truth written by the masters. My niggas is chilling, getting high, relaxing, envisioning ownership. Yeah, it can happen. What do we own? Not enough land. Homes, not enough banks to give my brother a loan. What do we own? The skin on our backs. We rent and we ask for reparations. Then they hit us with tax and insurance if we live to be old. What about now? So stop being controlled with black zombies.
Walking, talking dead. No, we think we're living. Black zombies. We just copycat. Following the system. Black zombies.
Wake up. Black zombies are the spell for more than 400 years. Ghetto niggas won't have it no more. Can I get a witness? Listen to somebody else tell you how to do it when you can do it yourself. It's all in you.